it's hard to know what to do, and there's no crucible. There's no, like, rites of passage for young men anymore. And that's a tough place to be, I think, for us culturally. Like, we're very soft and comfortable in the United States. We're more comfortable than maybe every other country in the world. And I'm not thinking that that's a good thing. You know, I'm not thinking safety is a good thing. So I think one of the things that's been super important in my life is to, you know, like Keith says, seek death. You know, and whatever you're doing, do it like you could die. Do it 100%. Go after that thing with the fullest, because you might not be here again.
After the episode, head over to iTunes or the Apple Podcast app if you have an iPhone, or the Stitcher app if you have an Android device. Go ahead and subscribe and leave us a 5-star review. We really appreciate that. Enjoy.
Head over to shrugstrengthtest.com and take our free 3-day strength test. We'll send you 3 days of testing that takes about half an hour to about an hour each day. Each day you'll get exercises that we're gonna walk you through, showing you step by step what to do. Once you finish the test, submit your results, and then we'll send you a bunch of feedback showing you where we think you could be stronger and then how to fix certain weaknesses that you might have found. Head over to shrugstrengthtest.com to get started.
It doesn't feel good when I can't sleep at night. When I'm laying in bed and I'm like...
Yeah, I never get that way.
I know, like, some people that can drink coffee going to bed.
Yeah, easy.
If I drink it past noon, I'm up.
Really?
Yeah, I'm already ruined.
Huh.
Yep.
Past noon.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Wow.
Yeah.
You need to drink more coffee.
That'll pre-workout's the same thing. You give me, I can't even do
now,
it.
Now, this idea of a pre-workout, what is this shit? Because I heard about, I see guys and they're like, oh, you got this pre-workout? Do this pre-workout? And to me, a pre-workout is for a dude that doesn't have the goddamn junk gumption. Like, I mean, tremendously, it's like, isn't it something like, yeah, I really don't have shit together, so I'm going to do something that's going to amp me up so I can be present for my life. Like,
oh,
what
man.
The fuck? It's like, oh. that's for some weak-ass dudes, right?
It's just caffeine, most of the part.
Okay.
Yeah, most of what's in pre-workout is just caffeine. There's
really?
Some other stuff. Yeah,
there's because there is some other stuff. Because there's some federal lawsuits about some other stuff being in those. So there is some other stuff in those,
well,
right?
The pre-workout that I take has caffeine, beta-alanine, creatine. That's pretty
good. You know what I like about you? I like that you know what's in there.
Yeah.
Because most people are taking shit, they have no
idea
what's in there.
Oh, no, they have no
there.
Fucking idea. No fucking idea.
What's in a frappuccino? I don't know. Sugar?
But, you know, I started drinking more black coffee before training.
Yeah,
so,
that's racist there. What
I mean,
just
well,
said.
Yeah.
I can't believe that. But anyway, this is a
put
family
no cream
show.
In my coffee. Fuck that shit. I mean, I do sometimes.
You know, why not?
You know, hey, whatever.
Man, you rattled me for a minute. You made me question why
I
actually
drink
that shit.
I know. You know what? I'm fuck the. Maybe
hey,
I don't take pre-workout.
You know why
anymore.
I drink it? Because I get amped up anyways before training session. But if there's a next level that I can hit, I want to know. I want to know what
why,
that's
where
like.
Where are you going?
Goddamn, what are you doing?
You're trying to blow up the gym. That's what I'm trying to do.
Where are you trying to go?
I was going to say the Olympics. That's not true.
What's the?
I'm just trying to PR every single time I touch a barbell.
Really?
Yeah.
You think that's healthy?
No, not all the time.
Do
but,
you think it's sustainable?
But how do you? No, absolutely not. But when I want to get the highest numbers I can,
right?
Like sometimes you need that intensity.
Okay. All right. Well, my prayer for you is that one day you'll be able to get that intrinsically.
Oh, please believe me. That. When well, after a day like that, it's like 10 days of not that.
Right.
For sure.
Right. So you just take the pre-workout on the day that you're going to do the thing. Don't lie to me, you motherfucker. Yeah, it's all right, bro. I understand.
No,
I understand.
I
it's just something to think about, just something to consider.
I'm trying to think about how often I take it.
You got to think about how you make yourself weak in this life. It's not, you're going in the gym going, I'm going to get that good bicep peak. But maybe what to think about is think about cutting away the weaknesses in your life other places. Because all we do is we cleave to comfort, and we think that's success. And I would say that comfort is akin to weakness, and comfort is like death. And that is going to swallow you up and edge away at you like a tumor more than anything. So the places where I get super comfortable in my life, I'm like, you better bring in some pain here. You better get uncomfortable. And so, like, how are you a fully self-sustained human? Or do I need these other things to make me whole?
I didn't even know I was doing anything wrong.
I'm not saying you are. I'm just saying it's something to consider.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
I feel so empty now.
I mean.
Welcome to Barbell Shrugged. I'm your empty host, Mike McGoldrick, here with Alex Macklin, CTB behind the camera.
We're getting schooled right now.
Getting drilled by Tait Fletcher and Keith Jardine. Keith's just sipping and just enjoying the show.
Just watching
me shift uncomfortably in my chair. Turning bright red. Guys, thank you for coming on the show. We're here at the Paleo FX, the Caveman Coffee booth. You guys had a really cool setup. You have a show for yourselves. For those of us, or for those of our listeners out there who don't know who you guys are, tell us a little bit about yourselves.
KJ.
I'm a proprietor of coffee right now. I'm an actor, stuntman, used to fight in the UFC. Used to be a wildland firefighter, a football coach, a bounty hunter, plumber, done a lot of things, but now I'm here.
Mine, you work.
You were
mine.
a bounty hunter.
All right, Rich senior move over.
Yeah, I read your bio before you coming on the show. You tracked down like a thief recently. It was on like a video.
Oh no, that was a different thing.
Somebody fool enough to steal mail out of Keith Jardine's mailbox.
Oh shit,
get out of here.
Yeah, I was sitting in my computer. I was doing some work and I saw somebody pull up outside the window, and someone slowing down right in front of my mailbox. And the guy jumped out, pulled my mail, threw it in his car, and jumped in and left. So I'm just there in my underwear, no shoes, nothing. So I'm running around the house. Oh, my God, oh, my God. I try and find clothes, put clothes on. I found some dress shoes, for God's sakes, the only thing I could find right away. So I jump in my Bronco at the time, and I head after him. There's only one way in or out the neighborhood I was in, so I knew he had to go there. He might get some other mailboxes and go up there.
To give a good background to what Keith's neighborhood is it's basically a retirement community, right? And so when Keith moves in, they're like, who's going to talk to him? We're going to talk to all the neighbors. And then somebody so, you know, it's not really a party neighborhood. It's kind of a lower vibe around here. And Keith's like, no, yeah, of course. Like, you're all soft-spoken. So, anyway, it's a type of neighborhood where you think if you're a thief, maybe I'm going to get off easy here. These are just easy marks here. And then you got Keith Jardine in dress shoes running after you in a monster truck.
Oh, my God.
And so, wait a minute, you apprehended the dude.
Yeah, so I chased him, and I saw him. I saw his car. I think that's him. And I sped up, and I drove right next to him. And sure enough, it was him. And then so I sped past him and slammed my Bronco right in front of him so he couldn't go. So I remember running around the outside back of my Bronco, and I kind of see his car and I see his window open, and that was the best thing for me right away. You know how you think and like everything kind of slows down or whatever?
Yeah, yeah.
So the window's open, so I know that there's no real barrier between me and him. So if he does have a gun or something, that I'd be able to do something. So I swerved way around back to behind him, and I came up and I grabbed him by his collar. And he started fighting me, whoa, what are you doing? He's fighting me. And then so that's it. So I'm pulling back to hit him.
And that's it.
Yeah.
That's the trigger.
Yeah.
And it's funny how there's that primal thing where this connection we all have is like the moment he saw on my eyes somehow that I was about to hit him, he just went like jello on my hand.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
He knocked himself out.
He just went completely limp, and I opened his door. I reached down and I pulled him out, and I got him on mount, and I called somebody.
And this video, I think this video was caught on video and it went viral.
National news.
Oh man, we gotta plug that in.
We gotta watch that.
So here's a little side story that my fiance makes fun of me all the time for this because I got this guy. I got kind of knee on chest kind of position. I pull out the phone. And I'm calling. I don't call the cops or anything. I call my friend and my manager from fighting.
Can I hit him?
No, I call John. I call John. I got this guy. He did this and whatever. He's like, don't worry about it, dude. I'll call the police. I'll get taken care of. Whatever. So why don't you call the cops? And my first thought was John's always the guy that's been there for me or whatever. Yeah. I just called John.
Oh yeah. Man, that is crazy.
And you're also accomplished MMA fighter. You had an MMA career.
Right? Yeah. I fought in the UFC for a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was your record?
I have no idea, man. I've won some big fights, lost some big fights. You, I've been all over, yeah.
You fought Chuck Liddell?
Yeah, I beat Chuck Liddell, Forrest Griffin, Brandon Vera. I beat some good guys.
Yeah.
Like, that's what I say when people ask, like I've won on the biggest stage in great ways, and I've lost on the biggest stage in great ways.
Yeah.
Like, I've been on both sides of it.
And so. What have you kind of been doing since – and you retired from MMA or UFC, right?
I guess. People ask me if I retired all the time. I just can't – I don't know how to – it just sounds so like I give up or something. I haven't retired. You know, I train all the time. I still live a certain lifestyle. Like, I just can't say that I've retired, even though, like, I don't see myself – well, I mean, you never know. I'm just day by day. I do my thing.
Just living.
Yeah, doing this coffee thing right now, doing with Tait, doing the stunts and the acting, and now this coffee thing's getting so big for us. Like, it's just day by day seeing what's happening.
Right on.
Yeah.
And a little side note to that story. It was Tim Sylvia that was in the car, and so that's who he pulled out.
Oh, man.
Stack of mail next to him.
I wonder if that guy knew, oh, man, a celebrity lives here. Oh, he probably knew afterwards. Good mail.
Imagine, though, how crazy that is.
What was that thinking?
No, you're being a just guy. You're just taking care of your thing. And this guy's a thief. Like, it had to go through that guy's head. I wonder if I could sue him. It's kind of like doing the right thing. You know, you're in this position with no matter how kind you are to somebody that is being offensive to you, maybe physically, maybe just stealing from you, whatever. But it's a trip, man. It's nice that it went how it did.
Yeah,
it is. Yeah.
And you're lucky you didn't smash him.
Yeah, he didn't fight back.
He didn't have a gun or a weapon.
Yeah, it's just one of those things, like I'm not – you don't really think about it, you know. You just
– in it.
You're primed to react a certain way to certain things, and maybe it wasn't the right thing to do, but that was just
– that was just your instinct.
The decision was made up long before it happened.
Are you head of your homeowners association now?
No, it's a bunch of old people, and that's what it was, and that's what the fuck it was doing, is, like, trying to steal old people's pensions and stuff, you know?
Fuck that guy.
Yeah, yeah.
I think you did the right thing.
For sure. 100%.
For sure. Yeah. Tay, give us some background on yourself.
That's the most eloquent background I ever heard. I never heard Keith talk like that before. Did you rehearse
I'm
that
glad
shit
you feel
or
comfortable.
What?
No, man. I had, had some...
I'm a coffee proprietor, actor, stuntman, used to fight professionally... I was a bounty hunter. I did transports. Bounced in clubs.
I
a carpenter and a roofer. How far back? I used to sell drugs. I've robbed some people in my time. Thank God I never ran into Keith Jardine.
Right. For
I was about
real,
to
right?
say, Tait's got a book coming out right now.
Oh, I'm writing a book right now. I'm a aspiring author. Yeah. What else? We do Pirate Life Radio. We run a podcast. What do we really do for real? Oh, and then I've got Nuevo Cerveza. I got a microbrew with a buddy of mine. We just signed a little tap house up in Santa Fe where we'll be doing a coffee and tap room kind of little general store type deal.
You got Concrete Cowboy. No big
Concrete
deal.
Cowboy. There's one here in Austin. Some little bars that are around, one here in Austin, one in Houston, one in Dallas.
These little clubs are doing amazing.
Yeah, they're fun, man. So down on West 6th Street here in Austin.
Got a lot going on.
You can go tonight and go check it out. And what else? We might be opening a coffee shop in Houston. We got a couple of really big projects, and we got some really cool stuff on the coffee forefront, stuff that hasn't been there before. And I think that's one of the most exciting things about where we are right now is people always ask, they go, hey, how, you know, and they're like, you're big in the CrossFit world or in the powerlifting world or in the fight world or and it's kind of like, you know, all of our lives, we couldn't like predict, like Lacey is their third partner in Caveman Coffee and she split, but she's, you know, she was saying on an earlier podcast that somebody, cause she's trained the highest levels, like sought after to train the highest levels of actors, like guys that make $100 million in films, and so she's been a personal trainer like that. And people ask her, how did you get there? How did that occur? Now I can tell you how, but you can't do it. Like, you're gonna have to do it your way. And that's the world we live in right now. It's like, it trips me out all the time when I think about Keith is how our lives have interweaved, gone away, like, and then come back together, and like, It's been a trip, but I couldn't have predicted it, or I couldn't have even like made a game plan for it. Like, here's where we want to go with this. These are all things that occurred. We're in love with our interests, and then we've tried to embolden our interests and honor them and the people that had taught us and led us along the way, I think, and we have a certain kind of ethic and a code of honor, I guess, if you will, to not sound cheesy or something. And that's brought us together, and that kind of speaks through the things that we do. And we just try to put cool shit into the world. And somebody on a show a month ago or something had asked me, what advice would I give to a young entrepreneur or somebody trying to do something, right? And especially in this realm, like, all over, everybody's a trainer. Every mm-hmm. dickhead that you know that graduated high school, and they're like, well, I played football and I know how to do it. I got a 225 bench press. I'll get after this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because it's hard to know what to do, and there's no crucible. There's no, like, rites of passage for young men anymore. And that's a tough place to be, I think, for us culturally. Like, we're very soft and comfortable mm-hmm. in the United States. We're more comfortable than maybe every other country in the world. And I'm not thinking that that's a good thing. You know, I'm not thinking safety is a good thing. So I think one of the things that's been super important in my life is to, you know, like Keith says, seek death. You know, and whatever you're doing, do it like you could die. Do it 100%. Go after that thing with the fullest, because you might not be here again. Yeah. And I think that's a hugely, vitally missed step that we have in how we're educating young people. I try to do something frightening every day. Mm-hmm. I try to get after my discomforts until I become, like Coach Greg Jackson would always say, you got to become comfortable where other men are uncomfortable. And when you get into those positions and you become a master and have dominion over yourself spiritually, intellectually, emotionally, physically, well, that's when you have something to give and offer. But it takes time to build that. Mm-hmm. And so I think we miss those things. And so everybody looks after, I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to run a business. I want to be a coach. I get a blue belt or something in jiu-jitsu. I'll start a jiu-jitsu gym. That's going to be awesome. It's like, I can't tell you how dumb you sound right now, you know? And the thing is like, build yourself, and then you get to become something later. But mm-hmm. having nothing and an idea doesn't make you something. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like if I were to say, well, what would make you successful? If I gave you $1 million, would that make you successful? Fuck no. It just gives you $1 million. You know what I mean?
And you didn't do shit for it.
Right. Yeah. To the degree that we could be helpful with others. Right. Mm-hmm. And to the degree that I could be helpful is the way that I've made myself useful. How adept am I at being a human? Am I a professional human?
Right.
Or am I kind of mediocre at my shit? Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I think about it all the time. So, like, with the stuff that we do, we're like, what can we put in the world that's not there? Where's there a lack? And how can I help the community around me? Not like, how can I help myself? How can I make the community around me prosper? Whether that's my family, my town, my people. Those are the most selfish ways. The people closest to me, that's the most. How do I get global? We all want to think, go Lions, or whatever your fucking team is. Go America. It's like, at what point am I rooting for humanity? Yeah. And then at what point am I rooting for the air that I breathe? At what point am I rooting for the oceans that I can swim in still, thank God, but maybe not in 10 years I won't be able to. Mm, yeah. Because we humans, I was at Eddie Bravo Invitational, this jiu-jitsu tournament, and I took a picture of this toilet that's wrecked. Piss, toilet paper, everything. It's a crime scene in there, right? And I make a post and I go, humans are a trip. We treat a toilet as if we're never going to need it again. Hmm. And that's how we treat the earth. You know, that's what. And so, like, as far as, like, thinking about entrepreneurialism or products or this or that, it's like, how do I get a higher mind about thinking about what's really going to be beneficial to the world? And whatever, you know, like, that. I think it's a huge conversation to have. And I think it's a really important aspect for young men to go through. But I don't know, that's just what I've been thinking about. I feel like I just ranted all day.
I haven't even talked about barbells.
Fuck.
No, that's all good.
Preach on. I want to ask, you know, that's a powerful message. Like, what led you to that mindset? Because did you always have that kind of confidence? That's this always, like, this driven, powerful,
I don't,
like,
have any confidence now.
Yeah.
I mean, well, I would say so. I mean, you guys are doing some big things. And
I'm doing things,
you do a lot of
different
things.
I don't know. What do you think, Keith?
What led you to that?
Yeah, I don't know, man. I was talking to a kid the other day. That what's he doing with his life and all that? Like, a really bright kid and all that, and he's working every day. But what does he go home and do? He goes home and he plays with his friends on video games and he whatever drinks, whatever smokes, maybe whatever. And but then he goes to work again. But he has these dreams. I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to do things and stuff. Well, what are you doing with your free time? You know, you do mm-hmm. your work every day. Like everybody has to pick up a job right away. It's a crummy job. And you do that thing so you can do some work to do something you love.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I happened to find fighting at a certain thing at a certain time in my life, and that's what I love. And I gave everything I got all my free time. Mm-hmm. Went to that. I did two jobs on my free time. Was to train for fighting. And it's just like I learned how to do that. I learned that lifestyle. And then now fighting's over, and now I love to act. And I'm doing this Caveman thing. So all my free time is built on learning how to be an entrepreneur and learning how to be a better actor. Mm-hmm. And it's just this art that you have. You got to have an art in your life that you struggle with every day. It's something yeah. that tortures you down into your soul. That how do I become better at this? And how do I train smarter?
Yeah. Tortures
and not
you
harder.
Your soul. Yeah, huge.
Yeah.
That's what I was gonna say. By a quick answer, when you're like, how do you get that? I was gonna say, the one thing that popped in my head. Misery. You gotta fall in love with being miserable.
You gotta fucking grind, man. People want to do shit. And they wanna be an entrepreneur. They wanna be a badass weightlifter or a powerlifter or a CrossFitter. But if you don't want to put in the work, how do you expect to do anything?
But then there's the realization that it sounds like it's suffering and it's really hard your life.
But that's the journey.
That's the juice.
Baby. Yeah, that's like juice. If it's hard, it's gonna feel good once you get that.
I think it's this, man. I get it. Like. I've always had it. Like, I never wanted something that I didn't merit. I didn't want, and most, I guess I'd say ego. And maybe it's a healthy expression, the ego, in a way. But I didn't, if I had some shit and it was given to me, I knew that if I was on the outside, if I was your eyes looking at me, I'd be like, yeah, but he didn't earn it.
Yeah.
And that's a real thing, man. Where I grew up, it was just like that. And so then in fights even, I've won fights or in grappling tournaments or something where I didn't train. Or I didn't do it justice. I didn't do honor to the people that had showed me how to train or whatever, and I won. It's fucking empty, man.
Right. There's no value.
I don't
there.
Give a fuck if you right. win. I don't care. And I know that there's a lot of other guys that feel that way too, because we have conversations like this, man. And so we would call it that. We'd go, oh, I didn't earn it. Mm-hmm. And you would say that, and only other dudes in the room would know what you're talking about, that you didn't earn that win. You know. Mm-hmm. And you earn it before you walk in. You earn it before you slap hands. You know, did you earn it? Did you suffer? Did you get that? You know what I mean?
Did you pay the iron price?
That's the truth.
That's the iron price.
That's it, right? Did you pay the iron price?
You watch Game of Thrones?
Yeah, man.
It's almost like if there's no risk
involved.
I like
that. I wasn't born to this. I paid the
iron
price. Holy fuck. Yes, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
Lori's, I'm sorry.
Oh, nothing. Along those lines, that it's almost if there's no risk involved. You know, you maybe get to that point and you think, man, I wasn't challenged enough. I don't feel like I had to grind for this. And that's when they're the most fulfilling, is when you had to, like, when you failed along the way.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, that's where you learn.
Have you accomplished anything without failing along the way? And if you get there and accomplish it, either you're just really damn good or you weren't really challenged.
That's death to me, if you find that groove in life where it's for some people, whatever. We just do your 9-to-5, whatever. You just found this groove where you're a comfort and you do X amount of work and you get this back and this is the way your life's going to go and you whatever. Like, that's death to me. Like, risk every day, risk something, you know?
Yeah. Well, that goes back to what you were saying earlier. Yeah, it goes back to what you were saying earlier. Like, that comfort zone, you should be trying to push yourself out of that comfort zone. Yeah. And even in training, like, that's how you grow. That's how you get stronger. That's how you learn.
There's an old school punk rock thing that there's an axiom where they go comfort's the death of desire. You know, satisfaction is the death of desire.
Yeah.
Are you satisfied? I'm never satisfied. I'm always craving.
Yeah.
And that's something in me. And maybe people are like, that's an unsettled soul or whatever. We could have conversations like that too. But it produces a lot of good, man. And I think that thing of being satisfied, you got to be careful of. Like, I always, as a little kid, I was like, I just want to retire because this looks hard and I don't know how to do it. And you're all alone and your back's against the wall and you're like, fuck, man. Like, that was And now, man, I couldn't imagine it. There's so much I want to do, and death is right behind me. And motherfucker, I've got things to do. I've got fucking things to do, man.
Yeah.
And regardless of how you're living, I don't give a shit if you're a Navy SEAL, if you're a bank robber, if you're working at the post office, if you're a cat. What? Like, to think that death is any nearer. There's a great line, and it's one of the sophists or one. Maybe it was Marcus Aurelius, but he that says something like, you know, death is just as close to the idle man than it is to the daredevil, right? Mm-hmm. It's you're right next door to death no matter what. The illusion that it's not there because you're playing it safe, mm-hmm. it's right there. Mm-hmm. So how are you going to seek death, you know, no matter what it is you're doing? Because it's right there. And to live as if it's not is to live in a state of lack of awareness. Mm-hmm. Now, dumb people are unaware. That's part of the mark of being dumb. And so I think all of life in that way is, how do I raise my awareness? How to become more attuned? How do I start to see the future?
Well, how do you do that?
I think you watch and you learn and you listen and you become hyper aware. I mean, you become maybe paranoid even for parts of your life. You know, I used to read about mystery shit and stuff like that. And I read about a Secret Service guy, I remember once. And he's like, we got to take different routes every day because, you know, the people that are watching you never. And I thought, yeah, you got to be about it. You got to have your head on a swivel. And that's how life is. Life is a motherfucking war. It's not ease and comfort. It's ease and comfort. At the end of the day, I get home. I decide to not open my emails. Doors closed behind me and I'm feeling good. It's like, good. I have a couple hours of that relaxation. Mm-hmm. But then when I open my eyes again in the morning, man, It's fucking, the war is on, mm-hmm. man. Yeah. And you better be aware or you're not going to win. Now, you can survive in different ways, but is surviving living? Am I just here to survive? Yeah. And so I think there's these important questions that maybe don't have answers, but I think the merit is more in the question than in the answer anyway. Yes.
Yeah. I think that goes back to being aware, also being present. Like one of the things that we talk about is like, if you're in the gym and you're training, like, be there.
Yeah,
you know, like, have awareness. Like, be there at the gym. You are there to do that task and get that shit done, get the work done. If you're off, you know.
But or you're on your phone the whole time or whatever, right?
And you can bring that down to even just, like, be at the set that you're doing, at the exercise you're doing, instead of looking forward to, oh, then I got to do this and this and this. Then just be good at what you're doing right now.
Man,
and put 100% into it.
And not just for you. Because you're going to get the benefit from that for sure. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is the streets are watching all the time. And so there's some young kid that looks up to you and he's watching what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And you're doing some funky shit because your head's not in it.
Yeah.
You're literally doing the world a disservice. You know what I mean? It's like you're there to goddamn set an imprint. Show somebody something. Because people are watching and noticing. If you've got a strong presence, regardless if you know they are or not. Mm-hmm. And it behooves you to give the universe your best.
Yeah.
You know? And I think just being aware of that. I mean, I say all that shit. People are like, oh, I saw you biting your fingernails. For sure. You know what I mean? It's constantly diving
in. All perfect.
You're never there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You're never there. And so that brings up the next biggest thing about life, I think, is who are you surrounding yourself with? Because if my finger's in my mouth all the time, he's going to slap my hand. You know, have somebody around that you trust, that you know loves you, that you've got a group of people around you that are raising your vibration. That's the way, man. If you got some, and I don't care if they're your family or you grew up with them and they're your best friend from childhood, if they got fucked up consciousness, fucking later, I'll love you from across the street, but I can't fuck with you because that energy affects me.
Yeah.
And if I want the greatest good and the greatest output of this carbon being, I better be taking care and have awareness of who I'm around and what I'm around, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, fueling yourself with people and energies is just as important as what I fuel myself with when I eat, you know, for sure. Maybe
for sure.
More so. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, you are who you kind of hang out with.
For sure.
I mean,
my dad used to say that to me, and I was like, you cocksuck. That's a rotten thing to say because I hung out with some not so great guys sometimes.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But 100%
that's true. You see that a lot. People's fear of that kind of change or the inability to move out of something like that because maybe they are too comfortable. Maybe they have the friends they have, and they're just scared to have to – work hard to make better friends or someone that's going to challenge. Maybe they don't want to be challenged. Some people, like, why do we have this natural ability to almost kind of fear challenge?
Well, I think a lot of people fear unknown, too.
Yeah.
You know, they don't know what the next.
People choose poverty because they know it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Even if they're, I mean, I had one of my good friends when I was growing up, and I grew up in Michigan, and it was one of the most impoverished counties in Michigan, and he left and he got out for like a year and a half, was making good money, like really, really good money. Like I think he was doing $60,000-$70,000 a year, which was that was huge money, man.
Yeah.
It's fucking, I mean, fuck. And he was driving back to Michigan. He's like, I'm going to go back for a visit, man. I wonder if it'll be any different. I'm like, the shit is going to be exactly the same. Mm-hmm. Like there's going to be no difference. And he never left. Mm-hmm. You know, that was like fuck 20 years ago. Mm. And now, you know, doing handyman jobs and whatever. And it's not just, you know, to say this or that, but it's like that fear. I would see guys like that. How did I learn that? By watching my surroundings. I go, oh, that's an option too. Mm-hmm. You know, that could be me. Yeah. Anytime I see a homeless guy, I go, that could be me. Like, easy. Mm-hmm. I see a junkie in the street, that could be me, man. Mm-hmm. That's fucking, I'm just seconds and fucking centimeters away from being that guy. You better raise your vibration, Tait.
Yeah. What's kind of kept you from going there?
That kind of craving, I guess, inside, mm-hmm. you know?
You never know, like, when you talk about I was thinking about this the other day.
And because I won't quit. Because yeah. the people I hang out with. I'll quit on myself, but fucking I'm here, and you know what I mean?
So you're the enforcer. You're the
I just point to him as one of my closest friends.
Yeah.
I mean, the same with Lacey, the same, you know, there's I mean, I got a group of people around me, and it's like mm-hmm. I'm in it and they're counting on me. There's people counting on me.
Yeah.
There's people counting on me because I'm counting on them.
Yeah.
You know? And I've got more thought for them than I do me sometimes, you know? Mm-hmm.
Going back to hanging out with positive influences and people that are going to bring you up, you said that, you know, you want to be a model for someone else because you never know who's watching. Who has set that example for you? Can you, you know, have any mentors, people that helped you growing up?
Yeah, a ton. Keith?
Let's see. Mike Winklejohn's a big one for both of us. There's a man who's made his own
way.
That's
a quiet guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just how he moves.
Mm-hmm. He's the striking instructor over at Jackson's.
Okay.
Guy's a businessman. He's really thoughtful, and but again, he's very quiet. He doesn't advertise it to everybody. Only recently is he out in the front. People starting to know who he is. Mm-hmm. But he's been a role model for both me and Tait. Mm-hmm. Tate's showing me the way on a lot of things. I'm naturally one of the most introverted guys you'll ever meet, and Tate's kind of helped to bring me out of the shell. He's kind of opposite of me in that way, so that's why I think we match up so well.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't know, just always searching and looking for people in your life doing things that you might want to do. Like, mm-hmm. I see people asking Tait all the time, like, because Tait's made it huge in both acting and stunts. But, hey, man, I want to be in stunts. It looks like fun. Like, how can I do what you do? But that's not how you do it. You observe the guy and you watch the guy and, like, see what he does every day to prepare himself and all that and really learn what the guy's about. Don't do him a disservice and saying, like, you just tell me a couple words and I can go do what you do. And I've done that with him. I've done that with all people that do things that I think I want to do.
Right on.
Yeah.
I mean, I get it watching people.
Yeah, just watching. Yeah.
Like, and watching Mr. Winklejohn, man. I mean, one of the things that, you know, when I talk about confidence without merit or without substance, it's that kind of a thing. Guys like Mr. Winklejohn, guys like Greg Jackson, like there's, you know, Keith Jardine, like there's guys like that that are – There's bad, there's mediocre, there's excellent, and there's guys that are fucking above excellent, and those guys are all top grade fucking humans, mm-hmm. and I'd see all these other guys that are some subpar motherfuckers, putting out books, seminars, this, that, the other thing, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, those guys are just quiet and doing the work and doing the damn thing, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting juxtaposition, and so I was like, I want to be somewhere in the middle because I want to get paid for the work that I'm doing, but at the same time, like there's a real honor in that mm-hmm. in that kind of silence that you can keep.
Too busy walking the walk to talk the talk.
Then that's a big part.
They're walking.
That's the thing, though, isn't it? Though, because like I have it ingrained in me. Like I know how to work hard. Like I can go to the gym and work hard. I can work hard in life. I've done that, but that doesn't really. I mean that's the most. Probably maybe the most important trait, but it doesn't help you to get excellent. You got to find role models. You got to find people that's done it before that can help you choose the right way, work smarter, not harder, that whole thing. Working hard is the easy part, but finding somebody to show you the way, that's the hard part. Mm. And you got to keep your eyes open. And if you don't know what to do, you got to look every day like, I might want to do that. You got to have your mind open all the time because something's going to show up in front of you and you're mm-hmm. That's what I want to do. Yeah. That's it. Now, how do I pursue that? Find mm-hmm. somebody that's done that before.
Is that how? Like, how did y'all come to the Caveman Coffee? Is that kind of the path?
Just by a passion of coffee, and then we started learning more. And then the more you start vibrating a certain energy, like things start to attract. And mm-hmm. and Lacey had some free time, and we'd started like a coffee truck that would take to events, and then Keith and I were on a movie together. We started talking, and Keith met these guys that are these roasters, and like, but it just came for love of it. It came for the passion of it, and we just wanted to share coffee. It wasn't even that we thought of a business, I guess, that way. Mm-hmm. And I think of the thing, you know, I've been puzzling on what your question was about role models and how do you get that way, or are there guys that showed you this? And And I guess I'd always hoped there was when I was a little kid, you know. And then I noticed guys that, you know, you go out to light the world on fire and then you run out of matches kind of, and then you're left there mm-hmm. holding your dick and you're like, all right. So I didn't know as much as I thought I knew. And I looked at that and I looked at all the opportunities because dude, we're in a river, right? And opportunities are steady fucking mm-hmm. flying by us for sure. All the time, purposes, yeah. opportunities, everything. And I was blind to all of them. I never saw. And then in retrospect, when I woke up.
Why do you think you were blind?
Because I was obsessed with self. I had a lot of self-obsessed interests at that time. And I was living in a real monodimensional kind of way. So I start looking at things like that. And I. When he become aware of that, I had such shame and regret that I didn't take the opportunities that were a lot of times generously and graciously mm-hmm. offered. And I go, that's what that was. And I go, I'm never going to not be prepared to be utilized when an opportunity comes again. And so a lot of it is like there's a Latin phrase called via negativa that is like I don't learn by going, that looks like a great idea. I learn by going, I went with the shit idea. I thought I had all these good ideas. They were all this way. And then I go, okay, let's go the other way. Mm. And that's a lot of the way that I learn a lot of the yep. way. I mean, you know, if every time that you dip this way, you get punched in the face, you're like, yeah. okay, maybe I'm going to dip another
it's
way.
Trial by fire.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So a lot of that is like that for me. And so then I start noticing those things, and I go, I never want to not be prepared. And what does being prepared mean then? And I guess it goes back to the rites of passage in that way. You know, for me, being prepared is intellectually, spiritually, emotionally, physically. If I'm not prepared on all those fronts, then I'm deficient, man. Mm-hmm. And I see that a lot. A lot of guys are like, I need to learn to fight so I can be a tough guy. And there's a lot of guys that are like, I'm super intellectual, so I'm above the fold of all these idiots that are worried about their body. You know, that's a fucking base kind of way to go through life. And both people are wrong. You know, mm-hmm. and everybody's wrong in that circumstance. To not be well-rounded is to almost be spitting in the face of your creator. Like, you've been given all these gifts and assets. Why are you not getting yourself to the ultimate vibration of what this being can achieve? And I think about that all the time. And so I don't want to not do it all service and justice in that mm-hmm. way, I guess, is one of the things that drives me in it. And I think, you know, people are like, well, how do you find your purpose, you know? Fuck, that's a long time coming. I don't know. What's mm-hmm. your purpose? And then I got to go, what is my purpose? It's just like training. If you don't, what do you say to a new guy where do you want to go? Are you training you want to be a triathlete? You want to be a powerlifter? You want to be an MMA fighter? Like, what are your goals? If mm-hmm. I don't know where you're going, I can't get you there.
Right.
That's some of the hardest questions sometimes.
And so that purpose is something I think that unfolds. What I tell everybody is get dominion over yourself, over all the aspects of yourself. And then you'll be ready if the purpose ever shows itself. Mm-hmm. But God help you if the purpose comes right now and you're not ready, and then you're a mediocre motherfucking representation of that purpose. Mm-hmm. Well, that's a shameful fucking existence. Mm-hmm. Because there's all kinds of, like, if it's all just waiters, and you're like, oh, I could be a waiter at Denny's, or I could be a waiter at a 5-star restaurant. You're going to be reading different books if you're a waiter at a 5-star restaurant than if you're a waiter at Denny's. You're going to be having different opportunities with different clients if you're a waiter at a 5-star restaurant than if you're a waiter at Denny's. You're going to have different sets of friends. You're going to have different attention to detail about how you look, about how you present yourself, about what your diction is, mm-hmm. everything. And so, you know, when you put it and you go simply, would you like to be subpar? Would you like to be excellent? What kind of dickhead is it that's like, I'm good with being subpar? There's some out there, but it's that via negative. Yeah. I'd rather kill myself, man.
I hear that a lot, too. It's like, I just want to be okay. Like,
good luck.
Why would you want to be good. Fucking mediocre?
No, man, we need ditch diggers. I need you to, I need all that.
Yeah.
Like, good,
yeah.
good for you.
I think, like, passion is a big thing. Like, you got to have passion about what you're doing. You find that you have the opportunity, it comes to you, but if you don't have the passion for it, if you don't care enough, I think that's what's going to break you.
Yeah, you got to care.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a common trend. You get stuck maybe chasing after something that you're not passionate about, but the fear of getting away from that is something that people challenge, you know, that go through a big challenge with that. You guys, you know, starting something like this is really cool. You're here setting up this event. You're having a blast. It's probably – I'm not saying it's easy work, but when you enjoy it that much more, it makes it a lot easier.
Sure.
That's cool about here too. Is today is you got we got the owners here on doing this.
Right,
mm-hmm. Yeah. Tait and Lacey.
Yeah, it's yeah. That speaks highly about your brand. Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
Keith, what are you passionate about? What are you?
Life, man. You know, just right now, it's just day to day. Man, we're going down the rabbit hole here. What am I passionate about? I'm passionate about self-discovery, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm passionate about every day trying to find more about from I was this big to what happened to create me who I am right now, and just trying to discover myself and to grow that way. Mm-hmm. And that trickles off to every other aspect of my life, because all my weaknesses, whether it be with coffee or with acting or with whatever mm-hmm. else, is all stemmed from whatever is here from childhood, and so that's my passion right now.
Yeah.
We can go further.
What have you learned about, like, what have you discovered kind of about yourself?
Man, that's
you really got me, man.
I know.
You know, I'm very protective of. I don't want to get too much into this. I'm very protective of myself. Mm-hmm. I'm very much like I only let people see what I want to let them see. Mm-hmm. And to be able to be like, to be on a podcast like this, talking to you guys like 15 years ago,
mm-hmm. yeah.
No way, man.
You know, it's funny.
Well,
I used to walk up, like I knew, like he would go and drink coffee and read books after training and shit, mm-hmm. And so, but he didn't like to talk to anybody. But he'd be in a public coffee house,
yeah.
you
mm-hmm.
know,
yeah,
and so, but be nervous because. Like, people would come up and fucking, hey, can I get a picture? Like, it's. Yeah. And so I would always sneak up around the side and be like, hey, can I get a pic? Like, always.
Oh,
always. But, like, yeah, yeah, man, it's always. Like, it's a. It's,
I got my, one of my first jobs. I moved to Albuquerque from college. I was a college football coach, which I had okay time with. I was a personal trainer. And I got ulcer-like symptoms in my stomach because I was so nervous. I had to talk to somebody for an entire hour. What do I talk about? I used to have to sleep on my stomach on a bottle because my stomach hurt so bad because I was so nervous about having to come up with small talk for an hour.
That's hard.
Yeah. You got out of that quick?
Small talk kills.
Yeah, not quick at all, man. Like, I'm still, like,
still a personal
trainer.
So, yeah.
Well, I want to ask, so if you discover that about yourself, what's the difference from knowing...
Hey, I'm a fucking actor right now, man. Like, I go to...
Yeah, I was about to ask.
I go to auditions, and Tait and I were talking about this the other day, and, like that's all about. It's like, you got to just, like, I don't care about the way I'm talking right now. You just, there it is, man. Here's my soul if you're doing a good job. And that's why I love the art of that so much uh-huh. right now, because it's helping me more than fighting. Fighting, you can hide all those insecurities. You can be nervous the whole day of fight and just be a wreck in the locker room and get out to the fight and get hit a couple of times. Oh, now it's a fight. Now I'm going to go. Like, yep. like I got uh-huh. over that in all those insecurities. I hid that pretty well. And people say I look real tough. So I'm the most secure person you ever see.
Uh-huh.
So you can hide that in acting. You cannot hide that,
right.
man.
Yeah.
You go out in that audition room and you're completely butt-ass yeah. naked. And
Is that what you like most about it? Is the mental challenge?
It's helping me confront
facing
all
yourself.
Those things. Yeah. Yes.
Well, wow. I mean, it's you. Like Tait, what you were saying earlier, like you walk in an audition, like you gotta be fucking authentic.
I think that's what being a fighter is like too, in a way. I mean, for me, it's like that thing where you can distill and dilate time at the same time. Uh-huh. Like you can bring time down into this 2 minutes or whatever, or a 5 minute round, say. But then it dilates into these moments that happen are sometimes elongated. Something that looks like 4 seconds yep. to an observer becomes fucking 15 minutes, and you're in a different place, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there's all that happens. And so I think to go out, you know, I mean, we're all whores, right? Everybody's selling their wares.
Yeah.
I don't care if it's your ass or your intellect. If you write beautifully, if you're a beautiful painter, if you're selling your fucking time by being a cashier somewhere, everybody's selling themselves, and you're just – trying to barter for what that price is.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody.
Yeah.
And in that, like, you know, you're fighting in your underwear in front of fucking people for entertainment for other people. Like, there's no bigger whore than that. Like, that's, you know what I mean? Like, that's really the definition if we're going to talk about that. Mm. But
you're competing against somebody that's best of the world. You're what, top level, and he's trying to kill you in his mind.
Yep.
He's trying to freaking kill you, man.
Yep.
Like, it's the bare essence of all competition and all being is right there happening on display.
And so who are you in that position?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now who am I? Because there's this ego that I can defend over here of how it looks to everybody else.
That but won't then last what, long.
But yeah. then there's what's actually happening here, mm-hmm. and that's when he's talking about you get hit for. Oh, you're like, oh, here I am. I'm right here, right mm-hmm. now. There's no other time, because if I slip and I think about that, I'm knocked out or whatever, you know. And so when those are the odds, when those are the consequences, you look at that kind of distillation of time. Now you're looking like, and it's weird. Maybe it sounds weird to a listener, but then you distill it even more, because now you have 20 seconds in front of a casting agent in a room, and it's not the setting. It's right. and now it's all yours to fuck up right there. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing, when the consequences are steep, of like, it's either going to be a yes or no, a win or a loss, damage or no damage, or whatever. You start setting steeper and steeper consequences with smaller and smaller time allowances. Because if I slip up in the cage, I slip and I fall. Yeah. Well, I can get up and I can. If you do mm-hmm. that in audition, that's a wrap.
If you show a hint of nervousness, done.
It ruins yeah. the whole thing. Yeah. And so I think that's what I talk about. Like, I don't know if that explains it more, about like, how do you increase the consequences so that you have to live correctly, exactly. You have yeah. to have a real. Yeah.
You gotta be authentic.
I want to know.
Yeah. You gotta. Like we talked about earlier, you got to be present, and I think you've got to be authentic, mm-hmm. you know.
I wonder how much of that is being reactive versus being present, whereas, like, what about it is instinctual sometimes? So when you're in the ring, I mean, are you obviously want to be present, and you want to know so you can make decisions and move a certain way and avoid getting hit in the fucking head. But at the same time, you know, can you get your own way, get in your own head in the way that
both
that
the same
sometimes.
Thing. Being present is being reactive. So
okay,
if you're right in the moment, then you're gonna react right away. That's the hard thing, is yep. to be completely present, mm-hmm. and then so you can be reactive so quick when you start escaping that, thinking about whatever technique was or mm-hmm. or so. Did I hear the coach say this or whatever? Oh, mm-hmm. then you're not reacting right.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah.
That's well, when it's you a get balance. In trouble.
Yeah, yeah, it's like. So, like, I compete in weightlifting, and, yeah. You know, when you walk out on their platform, like, there's nothing but you and the barbell. Yeah. You are, like, in a completely present, reactive state. Like, you can almost feel your body responding almost instantaneously to, like, to everything that's uh-huh. going on. And that is
that
being present.
That yeah. bar leaving the ground, it's all happening so slow,
yeah, yeah.
but it's
yeah.
so fast, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
yeah.
And I think it's also, like, it's important to have the distinction between reactive and responsive mm-hmm. and proactive. And like there's a lot of that kind of, I'd rather be proactive in a fight. I don't want to have to be responsive in a way. I want to respond correctly. But if I'm reactive, maybe that's what he wants. Like you can mm-hmm. see it in fights where guys, like I always think of Carlos Condit and Nick Diaz. Nick's trying to provoke him and make him be reactive to him. Mm-hmm. Carlos is trying to respond in kind. And then Carlos comes back in and is proactive, and then he responds.
That's like, some Musashi tread down the sword stuff.
But you want to be careful of all yeah. that, right?
Yeah.
So you can get, like I said, life's a war. And so
yeah.
am I reacting when this guy acts like that? And what is that going to do for me in my future?
Yeah, I was
and
gonna
am
say.
I doing my future self any favors yeah. by behaving this way?
Yeah. I was going to say, how do you apply that to life?
It's everywhere. It's everywhere. It's when somebody treats you, what's in your estimation, poorly, I think. It's when you're offered a business deal and you're like, oh, I'm scared. If I don't take it, I don't want them to go away. And then you react to mm-hmm. it. Well, that's not owning your shit, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's like, and so it comes up in every nuanced way. And I think if you start to be thoughtful, there's a lot of guys that fight that don't think like this, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Right? This isn't like, oh, this is how fighters are.
Yeah.
Like there's a lot that do. But I think the biggest aspect of it that you got to bring forward is going, I'm doing this small little thing. How does that translate later?
Yeah.
Like, how does this small little thing,
third or fourth
right?
move?
Well, and then yeah. and then also, how is that vibration of the butterfly wing the same as if I faint? How is that the same as the way the ocean moves? How
honestly, that's a funny thing you brought up. I think the best fighters in the world do that innately. Like, there's a way, like, you can go through whatever battle, but you're still not there yet. It's still not happening innately. But there's ignorance is bliss, and there's fighters that's just they're programmed to mm-hmm. to have that kind of personality, and they're the ones that, man, just blow me away. That's more important than any kind of skill. You see guys in there that I know, guys personally, I can say, that don't have the best skill in the world, but are the best in the world, rated top 10 pound for pound in the world, just because they have that right mindset, and it's something that they just have.
Yeah.
And then you see the same person Tate talks about all the time that just has that thing. And then now whatever success, money, got knocked out or something like that, and you can see the second it changes, and every fight's never, they're not invincible anymore. And every fight from then on, like, then the thoughts creep in their head.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then now how do you bring that around again to now when the thoughts creep in the head, now I learn how to deal with those thoughts. Mm-hmm. And to get back to whatever mindlessness I was at, that's almost near impossible.
Mm-hmm. That's crushing. I watched the 30 for 30 a few days ago with the Orlando Magic, and Nick Anderson back in the day, it was a playoff game. He missed several free throws in a row, like one after another, and it was so much pressure that it almost seemed career-ending. You remember that, CTP? That, 'cause you could see it in the later games that when he would come back, he would turn away from doing free throws. It just almost sucked the life out of him. And it was rough to see because you just get so inside your head.
Yeah.
And reacting is exhausting. If you're constantly reacting, right, it is exhausting. Yeah.
There's a thing about responding correctly in the right situation, and that's what training is, right? Is mm-hmm. that, like, that's what you hope for. And it's the same in acting in that way, in that I've done enough repetitions, I've put in enough work, I've done all the numbers that when I'm in the fray of battle, I have to count on my training. I have to, because like everybody says, you know, if you think, ooh, I need to jab right after he hooks and I slip, and you're too late.
Yeah.
Like, you're already too late. You just have to, you have to trust your body and let it move. And you have to go into this altered state. There's an altered state that you have to go into. There's a great book on it. The Rise of Superman talks a lot about that. But if you're not able to let yourself go because you're so in your head because you're nervous, so that's how you have to have dominion over yourself. And that's why every day it's a different fighter. I mean, we were talking about Navy SEALs earlier. And what I thought about was, like, there's guys that ring out of buds that maybe on a different day would have never rang out of buds. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They're like, it's just like not every day you're the same man.
Yeah.
And so how do you tune it in? Like, that's the crucible. That's what every fighter, every coach wants to be able to do. How do I dial him in so that I can get the same guy that can get the same result every day? You can't.
Yeah. Yeah, we need him to show up on game day.
Yeah.
Yeah, I tell people, like, I tell lifters all the time, like, especially in their first meet or they're nervous, they're going into a meet, it's like, you just got to trust your training. Like, you know what to
trust
do. You got to trust your training. Mm-hmm. You've gone through the repetitions. You've put in the work. You just got to go and do what you know, what your body knows how to do, and just go.
There's a real art to throwing it all away.
Yeah.
To putting in all the numbers, to having it ingrained in your body, and then throw it all away and just fucking walk up to that bar and fucking go.
Yeah.
And if you don't do that, you're going to move clunky mechanically, and you're not going to get a beautiful fluid movement, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's maybe the biggest aspect is ingraining it in your body, so cellularly you're like I'm here.
Yeah.
This is
there's
what
no
I'm
question.
Yep. And I mean, I think it goes back to, you know, in training, you're pushing yourself out of that comfort zone. That's where you learn what you can do and what
that's
you can't.
That's where you live.
Yeah. That's where you live.
Got to test it
too. I don't know if it's the same in weightlifting because it's such big compound movements, but you know, they say practice makes perfect all the time, but like it gets left out that it's perfect practice that makes perfect, right? And so, like, even when guys shadow box or they do jiu-jitsu and they want to drill, everybody wants to go too quickly because they want to look flashy. They want to look a certain way.
Yeah.
The deal is, as slow as you can go to move perfectly, that will translate in real time, in speed, even though you're moving in slow motion right now. And I think that's the thing, is you gotta decide, do I want to be better or am I trying to somehow feed my ego?
Yeah. Yeah, there's your application to training. Did I leave today better at my craft or just did I just do more work?
Right.
Did I actually leave better at that movement?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Powerful.
I talk to people about that all the time. Going into practice is like, are you just going to go there? You're going to go there. You're going to drill three moves and then you're going to go spar whatever rounds. And you just go through the motion. You do what they tell you to do and you what? And you leave and you go on the day. There's a person that's going to improve maybe 0.5% every day. Mm-hmm. Or are you going there with a game plan? This is what I did last time. I was good at this, bad at this. I'm going to get better at this. I'm going to find a way to get to this position again and work on that. Yeah. We're going to drill. I'm going to find a way how those drills, those moves apply to all these things that I'm working
listen to
on.
What he's saying.
Yeah. That's
You listen to what Keith's saying right now. And what he leaves out is, and it just gets passed by if you don't listen. And he says, you got to find a way to get put in that position. He's allowing guys to put him in a bad position. How do I work this in a way that authentically, that I'm not telling you to put me in a deficit? I'm going to work myself into a deficit so I can work myself out of this. Mm. And I'm not going to fucking tell you about it. There's times when guys would watch Keith and I spar. I remember a guy one time, he's like, dude, you are whooping that ass.
No.
And I go, first, shut your fucking mouth. Let's not ever say that again. And what happens in here, you need to know that this is what happens in here. And the other thing I said, and you don't know enough to have a commentary on. That's why it blows my mind when fans have commentary on whatever it is. You don't even know what you're watching. Mm. And what that kid was watching is he's watching Mr. Winklejohn having a direction of going, hey, I want you to do these three movements, Keith. Work on this in sparring. And so Keith is married to that, even though he can knock me out whenever he wants. He's not, and he's moving in this way to put himself in a position. So he has to – that's true. That you can do that shit all you want, but that's real life.
Yeah.
You know? And so those are things. So what's the biggest thing is having your ego put out of the place where you go – I don't care if I look bad to everybody else. I don't care what everybody else thinks.
Yeah.
Because like you said, am I going to get better with this or am I going to be in the same conversation that I was in yesterday and I'll be in tomorrow?
Keith, I think that was so huge what you just said about having a game plan, like coming in. I don't think a lot of people do that. I think a lot of people just go to the gym and they're just going to go through the motions and just, you know, I got this. I got 5x5 today. I'm just going to do
this.
But
that's in life. That's in whatever you're doing, gym, whatever. Whatever you're trying to get better at, that's it. It just doesn't happen through reps. You got to come up with a game plan and leave and rate yourself at the end of the day. How did you do that day?
And how can you do better the next day?
Yeah. Stop wasting days.
And otherwise, you're going to be reactive to life or you're going to be proactive.
Boom.
Right? And where do you want to live? You know, am I going to be reactive to life? And that becomes, am I going to become a victim of life? Is life happening to me? Or am I happening to life? What do I want to put in the stream of life? Because death's right here, man. It's right tugging on my fucking shirt. And so you only got right now to put it in there. You better be careful what you choose.
Oh, man, that's powerful. Folks, we're going to leave you with that. Guys, we're almost running out of time. They're shutting down the building on us. Thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been really inspiring.
Yeah.
Real quick, anything you guys want to plug? Where can people find you?
The Caveman Coffee.
Watch Preacher on AMC, man. Keith's all through that bitch.
I was just
in the pilot. It's a badass. I think it's going to be better than Breaking Bad.
Tait and I have been together on probably 15 different TV shows.
We played Brothers on
It's coming out.
Warn everyone.
Yeah. We played Brothers.
Yeah. So check that out.
It's got the beard.
Check out Keith Jardine 205 on Instagram.
Okay.
I'm Tait Fletcher everywhere. Pirate Life Radio is my podcast. And
Pirate as fuck.
CavemanCoffee.com.
If they had one movie of yours to watch, what would it be?
There's this little kid show called Jesse, a Disney show. And it was awesome.
All right.
Because it's great to be admired. Little kids are like, oh, my God. You're like, I'm a cool kid with 9-year-olds. This is awesome. That's the best show.
Can I watch that now?
Yeah.
Is that out now?
Yeah.
All right.
But the best thing I think is so far, the most fun one that has been the biggest was Equalizer was huge, I think.
Oh, my God.
That was really dope, right?
You haven't seen that?
No, I haven't. I was going to bring up Sicario.
Sicario was dope, too.
Oh, man. Equalizer.
Didn't you kill a bunch of dinosaurs, too?
I shot a genetically modified organism of a pterodactyl.
You can barely see me, but I'm sitting
across the street from me. When I shoot out here, he's sitting right across from me.
Oh, man, that is awesome. Yeah. I'm going to check that out. Equalizer, I'll check it out.
Yeah, and then coming out shortly.
Huh? Yeah,
Jurassic World, yeah.
Jurassic World, okay.
And then
we're standing next to each other in John Wick.
Yeah. I got headshot, and then he got shot right after me running down the hallway. Pieced up, man. The Accountant, there's a Ben Affleck movie coming out that I don't know. I look forward to seeing what it is. There's a lot of damage on that show, but it was a lot of fun, too, man.
Okay.
It's killer.
Great. Appreciate it, guys. Thank you so much for your time. This was a blast.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.